All right, so it looks like we're recording. Excellent. Good evening, everyone. Islington Creek residents, attending city councilors, Honorable Mayor Beckstead, and City Manager Connard. The city appreciates each of you taking the time to join the discussion this evening regarding a proposed neighborhood parking program for the Islington Creek neighborhood. It's important that you all are made aware that this proposal is not a city staff initiative. Rather, this program, both in its original form in 2019 and the current proposed iteration, were researched and created in response to a request from some of the residents of Islington Creek in that neighborhood. That said, it's my pleasure to provide a forum for open discussion amongst the residents who will be affected by this proposed pilot and to answer questions to the best of my ability as to the history of this topic, as well as how this current proposal has evolved from its initial form in early 2019. At this time, I'll share my screen and show a brief PowerPoint to open the topic for discussion. And off we go. So a little bit about the history of the NPP program from March of 2019. The neighborhoods reached out to city representatives seeking relief from parking issues in late 2017. Discussions resulted in a directive from City Council for the Parking Division to research and develop a program outline. The Parking Division performed extensive research into similar communities, culminating in a discussion of the NPP program concepts on February 5th, 2018. Then there was an online survey conducted in March of 2018 for public feedback, and the survey results were used to create the initial program outline. Parking Division reached out to Islington Creek neighborhood, holding multiple town hall meetings, and the Islington Creek Steering Committee provided valuable feedback, leading to the 2019 iteration of a pilot NPP program for Islington Creek. This affected the current streets that you see in the map here, included Hill Street, Hanover Street, Tanner, Parker, Pearl, Rock, Brewster, Langdon, Cornwall, Rockingham, Cabot, McDonough, and so on. So this was the original program. So tonight's discussion is to remember the original program and then move forward to the changes and the current iteration of a 2021 proposal that is now being asked to be put before City Council. So the program general guidelines in March 2019, this doesn't cover everything, it's not intended to, but it does give some general ideas as to how the program might work. So the pilot neighborhood in this case was Islington Creek, borders were west of Bridge, north of Islington Street, Dover Street to the east, and then the railroad tracks on the north side. Dover Street to the west, and then railroad tracks on the north side. Owners, renters, and neighborhood businesses were eligible to participate in the 2019 iteration. Participation was not mandatory. Those opting out of participation were subject to a two-hour time limit, as any visitor would be. The program would be neighborhood-specific in this case, which would be just the Islington Creek neighborhood. Properties with driveways would be eligible for permits, and these are all questions that were raised over time. The decision was made to go with three permits per household tied to a vehicle, one guest permit to be permitted per household. Enforcement was to be 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. daily, including Saturday and Sunday. Violators were to be ticketed and then towed on a third offense. Fees associated would be determined by City Council. Residents would be allotted 4 one-day passes each given month for if they were going to throw an event. Permit should be considered a hunting license and not a guarantee, and they would need to be renewed annually. So those are some general guidelines to bring us all back to remembering what the March 2019 program looked like. The proposed adjustments to 2021 would be that all Portsmouth residents would be eligible as opposed to neighborhood residents only. Neighborhood businesses would no longer be eligible to participate under this proposed plan. Residents living outside of the neighborhood could purchase one permit. The price per permit during the pilot should be free for neighborhood residents, and non-neighborhood residents would be charged a to-be-determined fee by the City Council. The recommendation of this group is that the charge would be more than a parking pass at the Foundry Garage. The program would also then allow contractors to use a participant's guest pass, as opposed to going downtown and getting a contractor's permit, which was in the previous program. And then for parties and gatherings, a participant in this iteration would notify police 24 hours in advance, where the previous program required the use of the four visitor passes per household. All original streets would be monitored in this scenario, as opposed to just the revised program streets. So if we take a look, those would be the changes to the original program, or the 2019 program, I should say, to what's being proposed today. And this, the street adjustments include reducing or eliminating the following streets from consideration from the program of Cabot, Rockingham, Cornwall, and Langdon. And this is all north of Islington towards the railroad tracks. So the current proposal includes the following streets: McDonough, Brewster, Sudbury, Hanover, Rock, Pearl, Parker, Tanner Street and Court, and Hill Street. And with this being the map. So you saw the original map in red. This map is in blue, so try and help differentiate. You can see that Langdon, Cornwall, Rockingham, Cabot, et cetera, are no longer part of this particular equation. So that is a look at the 2019 program, the 2021 program. And at this point, we're happy to open for discussion as to the program in general, the guidelines, and certainly to the changes that are being requested by the group that is interested in moving this forward. So at this point, I'm happy to look at raised hands and ask and answer questions, and we can go from there.
And call on the first one, Ben.
Yeah, please go ahead and call on the first one, Eric.
You got Iris Esterbrook is the first hand raised.
All right, so please pose your question. Is my screen still sharing? I'd like to take that off if it isn't.
It is.
It's still sharing.
I'll figure that out while Iris asks her question.
Okay, thanks. And it's really a comment too. Hi, I'm a resident at 198 Islington, which is across from the mobile station, in a building that has 14 units, most of whom are senior citizens. The original proposal was really isolating for us because you couldn't really park on summer. To get over to State Street, you had to go down to Cabot. In the winter, you can't go through the park or at night. It just was untenable. This is an improvement in that some of the streets across Islington are now open to us, and we can also purchase one permit. But we still have concerns about where this leaves us for street parking. Thanks.
Okay. Next person we have is Jennifer Meister.
Excellent.
Can you tell me why the streets were eliminated?
So what I can tell you is that the 2019 program was presented and had a specific set of criteria for passing. It did not meet that criteria. This iteration is something that's new, that's been brought forth by a group of residents in the area. I would refer to that group to help explain why particular streets are no longer included. I don't know. I've been asked to present this program in this exact way, so we have done just that.
Well, I thank you for that, but I mean, as a resident of Cabot Street, it's just very frustrating because we have a lot of businesses from Islington parking on our street constantly, and it's really hard to find parking for the residents.
I understand that.
Okay, next is Ken Goldman.
Thank you for this chance to speak. I've got a few questions, and I was looking at the plan as it was presented before, and I'm not against this, but I just want to make sure it's done in a way that's really fair to all the residents in the area. First of all, I just wonder, I know people have this perception that they're, people from outside are parking. And I just, you know, I just have, the only question I really have is, anyone ever done a study, or is it just that there are more people living here now and more cars? And is it really being driven by outsiders? Since the current plan is only bounded from Bridge Street to Brewster, if there really is a problem, isn't there the possibility that that will then push the problem further down in the direction towards Dover Street? And you know, we should think about that. On the other hand, the program still includes all of McDonough Street. And if you look at McDonough Street from Cornwall down to Dover, it's very different than the neighborhood that's currently in the plan. There's a 72-hour park-free parking lot at the corner with Rockingham. There's a lot of parking along the street in front of the Safeway storage building. So I just really wonder, does it really need to extend all the way down McDonough Street? Another question is, it wasn't clear to me, if you don't need a resident parking pass, but you would like a guest pass for friends and relatives, is possible to get one of those? As you presented now and was presented before, they're talking about a tiered option for paying for permits. And I think that's patently unfair. I don't really truly understand. I live in the neighborhood, but not in the area that's now going to be covered. Am I still considered a resident, and can I get a resident pass because of that? Or am I just considered the rest of Portsmouth? And I think charging more than a monthly resident pass at the Founder Place Garage is really unreasonable and unfair. I think just charging for passes in general will be a deterrent to people from other parts of the city moving here, if that's what you're trying to do. And I think whatever you come up with, I think that should be the same rate for everybody in Portsmouth. And then one issue I want to talk about specifically is Islington Street. This was originally, the plan excludes Islington Street. And the justification for that was that, well, you already have controlled parking on Islington Street. You have a 2-hour limit. And what that does is it really puts people who live on Islington Street in a bind, because you can't park for more than 2 hours in front of your home, but now you also will not be included in the program, so you will not be able to park for more than 2 hours on the adjacent street. So I think that a differentiation has to be made between the parking on Islington Street and the residents on Islington Street. And the residents on Islington Street are also members of the community. And so if the streets that are adjacent to their block are included in the program, I feel that they should be included as in the same manner as the people on the streets in the program. I think that's only fair. And again, I understand why Islington Street is not included, because it already has controlled parking, but you know, it does put people who live on Islington Street in a bind. So I think the people should be included, but not the street. I hope that's clear. Also, I would think that it'd be nice if you could change the parking restriction on Islington Street to match what's being proposed for the other streets, rather than having it be a 24-hour restriction. One thing you mentioned earlier, I just want to mention, is that last time this came up, there was a requirement that 75% of the residents approve this, and only 41% voted to do that. And so I'm assuming that, you know, the new plan reflects, you know, the people that had a real interest in this, and that's fine. But I'm just wondering if the city is again going to ask the residents if they really want this and get a real sense of the community in that sense. Thank you very much.
Okay, so all excellent questions, Mr. Goldman. I was in in receipt of your email earlier today, so I had a chance to put some responses together for you. So this is why I didn't stop you and answer them one at a time. So the first question I think went to has a study been done? And so I can say that fiscal counts were taken during the summer months of July through September of 2018 before the Foundry became an option, particularly for downtown employees, which were the perception was that the group that was using the area the most and that was creating the issue were downtown employees parking and walking in. So those took place before that. And then we took more counts during the winter months of January through February of 2019. One of the answers is two, that there are currently 188 participants in the downtown employee program. So I think a lot of that traffic has moved to the garage to the benefit of the neighborhood. If we want to discuss what the counts were, the first thing to remember is that the parking industry looks for 85% occupancy as a benchmark for when to take action. For example, downtown, we're in triple digit occupancy and demand. So that would suggest that we might want to make adjustments to some of our policies regarding pricing and time limits and things like that. And I'm happy to discuss what those counts were in 2018 and 2019. But yes, the answer to your question is yes, studies have been done. The second question you had was, how is it determined whether a vehicle belonged to residents, at least in your email, and which cars did not? There isn't any way for us to determine whether a vehicle on parked on a street is a resident of a particular building. Even if they have an out-of-state plate, then they could be, you know, a recent resident. So there is no way to determine that. Your third question involved whether or not the surrounding streets would see some of what we would call bleed over from the neighborhood parking designated street area. Our research of other cities for the 2019 program indicated that this is often the case, that surrounding streets do start to see additional traffic from cars that would normally have been on the streets that are now part of the neighborhood program. So the next question is, does the program still include all of McDonough Street? And the answer to that is the current proposed iteration of the plan, including the area map, were taken from the 2019 program and modified to meet the requested changes specific to the 2021 model that is the subject of tonight's meeting. This included deleting Cabot, Cornwall, Rockingham, and Langdon, but did not request any additional changes to the coverage area. That's why the map looks as it looks. Again, it's a good time to reiterate that this is not a staff initiative. The city's not pushing forward with this from a city standpoint. This is an initiative that has been put forth by the residents of the neighborhood. And so we're trying to develop a program that comes from the source and comes from the folks that are going to be most affected by this. So this is what is requested, and that's why the map looks the way it looks. I hope that answers the question. The next one, is it possible for a resident to purchase a guest pass? My recollection of the 2019 program was that a non-participating household would be eligible to purchase a guest pass. So that without a request of change to that particular item, that I would think would still hold true with this iteration. The next question involved a tiered cost structure for neighborhood passes. My answer to that is this and all proposed parameters for are open for discussion tonight. I think what happened was some neighborhoods or some folks that lived in other neighborhoods but were residents of Portsmouth wanted the opportunity to park in that area if they could, and that this was a concession that was made over time that made an allowance for that, but encouraged folks that might be from out of the area to utilize the Foundry Garage instead, which I think is the genesis of the larger than Foundry price option kind of thing. So again, open for discussion. Originally the 2019 or 2018 version of the program did include Islington Street, which was later removed from consideration for the reasons that you listed. And that's the fact that it already has a two-hour designated for parking. Again, including or not including Islington or any other street is open for discussion tonight. The city is eager to hear what the constituents of this neighborhood want to see happen. The last question I think you had was regarding the 75% requirement. The previous city manager did put a 75% acceptance requirement on the 2019 version of this program. At that time, it was a little better than 41%, but it was not 75% of the residents approved. The proponents of the current model have asked that council approve a six-month pilot, and there are no percentage requirements attached to this request, and there are no community votes scheduled prior to that requested council vote at this time.
All right. Thank you, Ken. Next up, we have O'Leary Lane. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is O'Leary Lane. I am a resident on Hanover Street. Thank you for taking my questions. My first question is it possible to get a copy of this PowerPoint? I would like my landlord, and I would also, I know that there's some other residents that were unable to attend tonight, and they want to see the updates. So I'm wondering if it's possible to make that available.
Certainly.
And, okay. And how might that be done?
My guess is it looks like Director Rice might have a comment.
Yeah, we'll post it on the website. There's a city website. There's a page devoted to this topic, and so we'll make sure this information gets placed on that webpage.
Okay, I wasn't sure whether it was going to be placed on the Instagram account for this particular program as well.
If Instagram allows for links, we'll link it to that.
Okay, all right. Just thinking about how people access information, you know, getting you all into that social media thing here.
We'll tweet it out as well.
Okay, thank you. Oh, wonderful. Okay, great. One question I have then is, because I live on Hanover Street, if this program goes through, will residents have initial preference as far as getting the permits?
Well, a program like this basically allows, you know, only for residents to get permits. So, I mean, with the exception of the new designation for folks outside the neighborhood paying a price higher than Foundry Garage monthly resident pass, which I don't think would, you know, probably draw a whole lot of positive response. The current iteration of this program allows for residents that can, you know, obviously show residency at that location to achieve up to three parking passes tied to a vehicle. So you would have to show the vehicle registration and have the pass attached to a particular vehicle, and one guest pass.
Right. So what I was wondering is, will there be, in other words, for people that actually live in the affected streets, are they kind of first in line, if you will, in receiving
these? I
think
they're only in line, yes.
Okay. All right. That was one question I had.
Tell her it's also a hunting license too, so it does.
It's still a hunting license, yes. So to speak, Mr. Whalen. I appreciate that. I'm just trying to better understand, because there are a lot of people that live in apartments. It's more especially, well, on Hanover Street it is. So I'm just thinking, you know, out loud about some of the other questions people might ask. The other question I have is, in the plan you talk about monitoring. What does monitoring look like?
So monitoring means, you know, applying additional patrol officer staff, similar to what we do downtown. We would be working through the neighborhood every 2 hours. We enter, what typically happens in the downtown scenario is you enter a plate number and the device tells you whether they have a paid session or not. If you're in a non-commercial area like Islington and this entire area, that has a 2 hour time limit. You do what's called chalking a tire, but we do it electronically. You go to the front of the vehicle, you take a picture of the front wheel and wherever the valve stem is, if it's at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, that is recorded. And then you come back through in 2 hours again. And if that vehicle has not moved and the valve stem is in the same position, then you that ticket is then eligible for citation.
Okay, that's understandable. All right. And because I've only lived in the neighborhood a year, wasn't there a program previously where you did register your license plate with the city so that they knew exactly who was supposed to be parking there and who wasn't?
Well, the director can speak to this a little bit more, but what I do know is in place, and some of the signage it still remains around that area, revolves around a program that was discussed years ago that that didn't distinguish between neighborhood particularly or just New Hampshire license plates altogether. And there was no way to enforce that because there's no way for us to know whether a New Hampshire license plate lives in that particular neighborhood or in Dover or any other town.
Understood. And then I just wanted to make sure that initially in the 2019 plan that every household had, I think you said four passes. I wasn't clear about what the 2021 plan offers as far as number of permits per household.
There was no change to that particular element. There was three eligible per household tied to a vehicle. Yes. If a person only had one vehicle, they could only get the one pass, and then a guest pass would be allotted as well.
Okay, thank you for clarifying it. That's my question. My questions. Thank you.
Thanks for joining.
Thank you, Ollery. Next up, I see Iris has her hand raised again, but I'd like to take the other people who haven't had a chance to talk yet. Virginia Davis would be next. Go ahead, Virginia.
Hello. I've been living on McDonough Street for 10 plus years now, and I can honestly say there's nothing worse than working all day and coming home, especially in the summer, and you have to park way outside of your neighborhood just to go home. And it's pretty infuriating, especially when you see in the summer, we've had instances on McDonough Street where there's been RVs parked, there's been boats parked here, you know, that takes up more than one spot. And I was wondering if this program would address that.
I would suggest that any vehicle that did not have the permit affixed permanently to the windshield would be subject to the 2-hour limit.
So would that include, I mean, could you purchase a permit for a boat or an RV, say?
That question has not come up. I would suggest that would be open for discussion as to whether or not non-personal conveyance vehicles are eligible. I don't know the answer to that.
A lot of times, you know, that takes up more than one space. So that's you know.
I think that's a very valid point. I think it needs to be made.
Yeah. And in the summer, more so than any other time of the year, of course, we notice an influx of people, visitors, especially on Friday and Saturday nights.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I mean, with that, obviously, these would be people that wouldn't have permits necessarily.
Correct.
If they're coming in for the night. And with the hours of monitoring this be included in those evening hours on the weekends?
So the hours that are proposed are 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Sunday.
Okay, so it could still be pretty busy. You know, I mean, after 8 p.m. is when all the fun starts. You know, and that's when we see all the you know, the parking spots in front of our places taken up.
Okay.
So that probably really wouldn't address that problem.
So my suggestion would be that any and all questions that remain, we can have another forum or, you know, we have representation at council for a reason. I think that those folks need to hear positive and dissenting opinions on this program so that an appropriate decision can be made at the council level as to whether to go forward with the pilot.
That's great. And only one other question. Has it ever been up for consideration as to make these streets in the Islington Creek neighborhood resident parking only, like there is a little further north of us where Heinemann is situated right now? There's resident parking only going towards Hanover?
I'm not certain. I'm
talking, like right at the intersection by Rock Street and you're heading towards downtown. Right where the package store is on the corner there, that street.
I think those are the old signs, I think, that are still up.
So that still isn't valid, or?
That's there's no way to enforce the program that was in place at the time. We sometimes take the signs down and they find their way back up. So, you know, when you get to Bridge Street, that street is monetized. So that would be the boundary there. To answer your question, I would refer you back to the map that we showed you of the current iteration that is being presented to us for council to consider. And if council approves this, then we will execute as ordered.
I think even making the little parking lot down in the center of McDonough Street, even making that resident only would help a lot.
That is on the current iteration of the map.
That would help.
Yes, McDonough and Rock.
Rockingham.
That's one, Rockingham, yeah.
Yeah, because I know there's businesses conducted in the Safeway storage.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
And, you know, we get a lot of people parking on the street.
Understood.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Virginia. Next up, we have Dan Umbro. Go ahead, Dan.
Thank you for having me tonight. Appreciate you guys holding this meeting for everybody to provide feedback for the proposed program. I know some of you recognize my name, and I'm intimately familiar with the 2019 proposal and program. And when I saw a flyer put on my car last week, I was glad I got notification, because I wouldn't otherwise have known that this program was, jump-started again. And, I want to echo a lot of what Ken Goldman said. I think he hit on a lot of really good points.
He did.
Primarily, I think by putting a neighborhood parking program in a specific set of streets, we're inevitably just going to push the problem either further down the road or up the State Street extension. And, I heard Ben earlier, you talk about, the studies that other cities have done and the, repercussions of implementing these programs with how, parking would be affected in surrounding neighborhoods. I also think that, obtaining a guest pass is entirely inconvenient, and this program, one of my questions is how expensive is this? I know there's a fee this time around, but I remember in 2019 there was some grant money set aside to run the proposal. I'm assuming that's probably going to be part of this again, or not grant money, just budget money, excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, what my main question is surrounding, and I think I know the answer, but I just want to hear it from you guys, why businesses were eliminated from the program this go around. And, it's obvious that businesses weren't consulted in the construction of your current iteration that you got here. It was brought forth by residents, which is, fine. It does seem a little odd to me that, earlier somebody was said you were asked to present the proposal this way. I'm not quite sure what that means. Can I ask you to come and present the proposal on parking on, whatever neighborhood I want? I assume there's council support. And I'm just wondering if, we're doing our due diligence and allowing all stakeholders to be represented in something that's going to be endorsed by, the council and, implemented by the city parking staff. And then the last piece I would say is you mentioned your studies that were done in 2018 and 2019. I'd love to see those be made public so the rest of the residents in town can see the occupancy rates and just how, to be blunt, just how unnecessary this program is. And it's being driven by a few residents who are unhappy that, for whatever reason maybe they're rightfully unhappy in their mind, but I just don't think this program is very fair to everybody. And I don't think it's fair that other residents weren't included in any sort of proposal here. I'll stop now, and I'll just, if you have any feedback to what I asked, that would be great.
Certainly, Mr. Ovo, and like the previous emailer, I did receive your email ahead of time. So I'll just run through what you put in there, most of which you just touched on in your question. So I'll go through in the order that you presented them earlier today. Make the data available, as I mentioned, physical counts were taken July and September of 2018 before the Foundry was available, and again in 2019. I'm happy to make those available. Again, when that happens, just recall that the parking industry looks for 85% occupancy before we take action. So that will be a telling figure when you take a look at these numbers. And if directed by this evening, then I'll share them on screen. And additionally, a study was performed when the bridge lot was closed in the summer of 2020 to determine if people using that lot would turn to the Foundry Garage or to nearby neighborhoods. And that study showed a $22,000 increase in Foundry collections from the month in question, 7/24 to 9/8, indicating a vast majority of bridge lot users use the Foundry. Simultaneously, we did 76 counts at three different times of the day of the streets that are proposed in this proposal. And at that point, only Tanner Court, which has a 7 total inventory, reached an average of an 85% threshold. So some of these numbers, I think, are interesting and should be part of the discussion. So I agree with you there. One of the changes to the 2021 plan is to exclude neighborhood businesses. You may recall, Mr. Umbro, that including or not including businesses was a big part of the discussion of the 2019 iteration. It was finally decided that that businesses were taxpaying entities and residents of the community. And so they were included in the 2019 program and would be eligible for passes and eligible to vote on the program. But they are excluded from this version. Again, as to why that is the case, I would refer anyone to the authors of the program to ask what their reasonings are. I'm instructed to present the plan and what's going to go before council, and open it for discussion for folks to either be supportive of it or voice different opinions. So so we covered that one. Estimates, you asked about costs. Estimates for a 6-month pilot would come in around $54,000, $99,000 for 12 months. We've requested contingency funding in the amount of $100,000 be added to the FY22 budget in anticipation of this proposal passing. There is no government grant or any type of money that's coming to ease the load on that. That would be paid for through the normal process. I think that covers everything that you had asked, Mr. Rumble. Please, be kind and tell me that if I missed something.
No, that was great. And I appreciate everybody's time tonight. I'm looking forward to collaborating with everybody who crafted and who, to provide input on the program.
That's the healthiest way to do this. And I think reaching out to the folks that represent you at council and giving your positive or otherwise opinions is absolutely the way to go.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dan. Next up, we have Liz Bratter. Go ahead, Liz.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So one of the things that was in the other program that we had, and this is going to put City Manager Kennard on the spot, but one of the things, wake up, Karen, here we are. One of the things that was there was that the city manager would have the authority to add the other streets. So if it showed that we were getting the pushback, as Mr. Umbro Goldman mentioned, if the streets on in the neighborhood, in the Islington Creek neighborhood, since it's pretty separated from the rest by Islington Street, which would mean including Dover, Cabot, and the other side streets that weren't entered into this. And that was something that Mr. Bohanko had said he would just keep that in mind. And as counts came in during the 6 months, if in the first month they realized there's too much pushback into the other streets, that was an option that the city manager would be able to just put it into play. And that was just something I wanted to talk about. I also did want to mention that a lot of people don't realize that when their buildings are built, or actually anything is built in Portsmouth, that there are required parking for those buildings. So a commercial space isn't required to have any parking, and residential spaces are 1.2, I think hotels are 0.75. These are all divvied out everywhere you go. There was a parking, if it's a new building, there was a parking requirement that building had to fill. A lot of times buildings don't do that, they come up with an alternative, such as there's a building on Islington Street, a commercial building, and they are supposed to be parking, I believe, 20 something cars in the Bridge Street lot, which they don't, they park into the neighborhood. So it's important to realize where you are and what your building is and what kind of parking requirements it has and whether the owner of the building received a parking conditional use permit to allow them to use parking somewhere else, which may mean that you might be expected to park somewhere else, but nobody ever told you when you bought your condo or when you opened your business or anything like that. But that's just an informational thing. I don't have any other questions. I just wanted to see if City Manager Kennard would want to put that on her lap.
I'm happy to address that, and I'm not sure why you said you told me to wake up this. I think it's certainly something we'd include in the mix, but I would also say that if the council were the policymaking body that blessed a certain plan, I wouldn't unilaterally go and change that plan without conferring with the council.
Okay.
Perhaps Councilor Whalen wants to weigh in on that, or at the very least, bring it back to parking and traffic safety. Okay. Ben?
I can add a little bit to that. Good evening, Liz. Nice to hear from you again. The original 2019 iteration of this plan did give City Manager Bohinco an option to alter the plan along the way. Tonight's discussion basically focuses on the differences between 2019 and 2021. That was not something that was requested to be changed. So as it stands now, the city manager in the original rules and regulations before these modifications, whether they take place or not, would certainly allow the city manager to make decisions along those lines. And then again, I would defer to her wisdom as to whether or not council should be reading in on that, which I think is obviously appropriate because council represents the people.
Yeah, I could just add to that, Ben and Karen. I mean, I think that this is a pilot program. So I think the original and the other one was a pilot program. So I think the intent was to allow the city manager to tweak it if he or she had to, to meet the goals of the program. So I think that's not speaking for the council, but for myself, I think that was the genesis of it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Liz. Next up we have Robin Hustledge. Go ahead, Robin.
Hi, Robin Hustledge. I live at 27 Rock Street, and I am a member of the Islington Creek Neighborhood Parking Program Committee. And I just wanted to respond to some of the comments, such as the streets that were removed in the 2020 program versus the 2019. We didn't ask for that. We got the next iteration given to us with those streets removed. And in fact, we asked for three streets, which were like Hill and Tanner Court and Tanner and Parker, to be added back in because they're closest to Bridge. We would love to see the original streets back in the mix because we anticipate that, people that can't park here will then move on down the road, so to speak. So anyway, that didn't come from us. I don't know where it came from to remove those streets, but it did not come from the committee in the neighborhood.
Okay, so the document that we received in 2020 before COVID hit requested that those streets, that seven streets be removed. And then this newer 2021 version requested that three or four of them be added back, and that was Hill Street and whatnot. The city has not taken action in one direction or another as to whether to add or subtract streets. This has all been driven by community input in either direction. So it needs to be made clear that this is not a staff initiative. Staff is looking to hear from feedback from the community so that we can apply a program that everybody can agree to and be happy living under. So. Right. The removal or addition of streets is entirely up to the neighborhood as far as I'm concerned. We followed along the process. It has been lengthy. It has gone back and forth a number of times, but the document that I received in 2020 prior to COVID, which stalled everything, which is now the living document that we're working off of, had already removed those seven streets and then added a few more of them back, leaving the four streets removed.
Right, and we don't know who removed those streets. That's what we were given. I'm just saying. So I don't know. And we assumed that the city didn't want to, you know, have to spend that extra effort and cost in doing that. They wanted to reduce the size of the pilot. So we're like, okay, that's fine. Let's see how it goes. So
I'm happy to speak to that. You know, I've got to put the same number of staff to walk four extra streets than I do to walk the streets that are currently under the mapping. So it makes absolutely no difference to the city as to the size of the area as originally projected. Basically Islington Street north from Dover all the way down or alleviating those streets, because part of the document we have from 2020, which is now governing the 2021 changes, said that the group that was presenting those changes wanted to continue to include those streets in monitoring. So there was no cost initiative for the city to reduce the streets. And again, the city has not taken initiative to reduce or add streets, or really, you know, and I've made pains to not put opinion or conjecture into this. From our standpoint, we simply want to understand exactly what you'd like to see happen. And when the city council votes on it, the parking division executes.
Right. So maybe the people living on those streets that didn't want to be included. I don't know. I don't know what the input.
Robin, why don't we, if the consensus is that the group would like to put these streets back in, you know, that's, we can take that information and report back to city council at the end of this. So we really, you know, it's a matter of, you know, as Ben pointed out, we're trying to accommodate the residents on this to make it a workable pilot effort. So, you know, if the addition of those extra streets will help make it this a successful pilot, then let's do it. So what we'll do is, you know, we'll take that information and we'll include that in the discussion when we report back to city council.
Okay, yeah, I mean, I would think that those people could decide that they want to be part of the pilot or not, would be my viewpoint.
I concur.
It doesn't affect my street. My street is part of it, and I think we should be part of it. Those streets, I would think that the residents there would say, yes, we want to be part of it or no. We want to see how the pilot goes first. I just don't know, but it didn't come from the committee. And also the committee didn't recommend that businesses be removed. So I don't know who did, but that's the format it came to us, is these streets were removed and businesses were out of the mix. So I'll just leave that there. I did have some questions. Will there be surveys done throughout the pilot so that we can, how do we give feedback? How do people give feedback about the pilot and what's working, what isn't working, so that, you know, the city manager could make tweaks if needed, and things could be changed up, you know, that maybe we have, you know, the streets are packed from 8 p.m. to 9 a.m., you know, because of all the partiers, I don't know. And so we need to extend the hours. So it would be helpful to have a way to be able to tell somebody what's working and what isn't working.
Well, certainly we're happy to take, you know, on-street counts throughout that period, which was the plan all along. I don't know, and Director Rice can help me with this, what types of forums are available to give comment for something like this. Certainly, you know, people are going to automatically just feel free to reach out to the clerk's office or parking clerk's office, I should say, to clarify. Or my office, and we would take that feedback there. But there, you know, if we feel like we're going to get a large amount of feedback, perhaps there's some sort of forum we can set up, or Peter, if there's something that's already available for things like this.
I think we can come up with a survey type situation, like we did when the first iteration was coming around, to get feedback on this. I think that's a really good point, Robin. And you know, we need a metric to measure against to say, right, you know, are we seeing success or not? Are we not seeing success? Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that, you know, why doesn't staff come back and we'll come up with a plan on how we will receive feedback and to help put that into a form that is going to be useful for folks to measure if this was a success or not.
Yep, because we want to know, you know, what the rest of Portsmouth thinks, what, you know, what the neighborhood thinks, different parts of the neighborhood, just a way to know. We want it to work for everyone as best as possible within a reasonable, you know, framework. So I think it's very helpful in gathering feedback as we go through the process.
I think the number one success measure is going to be, you know, do we have we achieved that 85% occupancy where 15% of the spaces are open, which is the industry standard, or do we want a different number than that? But the industry standard being 85%, does the program help achieve that? If we haven't reached that 85% as of present, and you know, then the question should be, you know, to engage at all.
I mean, the other way to do it, Robin, would be to have two roundtables during the trial period, just like this. Let the residents speak out.
Yeah, that's another way. It's just some way so that we can check in and give feedback, and people can free to, you know, give that information. Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. Next, we have Larry Cataldo. Go ahead, Larry. Oh, I have to promote him to a panelist. He's going to... older version of Zoom. Larry, are you there?
Not able to hear you, Larry.
It doesn't seem to have his, oh, I can see him on the screen, but I don't know if we can hear him.
He's there, but I don't hear him yet.
Get back to Larry if he's having some difficulties.
So why don't we obviously keep Larry in the queue and then roll on to the next one, and we can continue having our meeting. Larry, obviously we want to hear from you. So once we get that squared away.
Looks like he may be coming back here again. Give him a chance.
Looks like we have an image for Larry.
Still no audio. All right, well, we'll bring up our next person. It's Michelle Wirth. Go ahead, Michelle.
Hi, this is Michelle Wirth on Hanover Street. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay, Mary. So my husband and I live right in the middle of that rectangle that's completely surrounded by this new parking plan. And we're a little bit dismayed by the fact that this is happening again, because we are one of many neighbors we have that are completely opposed to this parking program completely. And it seems like it's kind of being snuck in when we defeated this before. The streets are city property. They're built by the city, they're maintained by the city, and they belong to all the residents of the city. And it seems like our neighbors want to own their homes, plus they want to also own the street in front of their house. It's not right for me to have to limit the number of cars I can park, whereas my neighbors across the way don't have to. Why do I have to pay a fee to park my own car when other taxpayers don't have to? When other taxpayers in other neighborhoods can park unlimited number of cars for unlimited number of days, but I'm restricted in my neighborhood. And it's not right to treat me differently because of where I live here. I have two adult children. We have a lot of cars. We understand the parking problem, but it's just the way it is. There's benefits of living right on the edge of downtown that we love. We all live here on purpose because we love living downtown, but there are costs to it as well. If you don't like living at downtown where we have all these parking problems, you don't have to. You can own a home with a driveway. You can, you know, park in the parking garage. You don't have to live here, you can move away. But I don't think it's appropriate that you should think that you can own the parking spaces in front of your house. And I don't think I should have to pay to park in front of my house when other people don't. I am a local musician. I play the cello with the Portsmouth Symphony Orchestra. And on a regular basis, I have large groups of musicians come and rehearse at my house. They come for a couple of hours, we rehearse, and then they leave. I run the fife and drum corps here in Portsmouth. Same thing, I have 8 families with children that come over and rehearse in my yard. Now I can't have my rehearsals to serve the city. It's not right to treat me differently and make me pay extra and put restrictions on my liberty when you don't do it to the other people in the city. Thank you.
So my response to that, Ms. Ward, thank you for your input. I would think that opinions that are in support of this program and opinions that are not in support of this program are equally important and definitely absolutely should be heard. I think that the best avenue for that is to ensure that the folks that represent you in the voting body on this situation, which would be the counselors, should hear opinions and thoughts from both sides. So please do continue to make your opinions and thoughts heard to the folks that are going to end up making the decision that we will be asked to execute.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Michelle. Next up, we have Andrew Schivoni. Go ahead, Andrew.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Sir.
Well, it's a tough act to follow. I'm going to be rooting in the other direction, given the fact that I live on Hanover Street here. Just a couple of questions. So the 9 a.m. to 8 p.m., I think I would love to see that 8 p.m. extended. Definitely a little bit. I think I'm getting home late. It would be beneficial for us to have, you know, if it was resident parking, to have it a little bit later as secured here. You know, there are resident plates up on the street, you know, as people do purchase homes and whatnot that do say resident parking. So I understand if that's not in effect, but yet a little bit somewhat misleading. So very, really much appreciate everything that people have done for the Hanover Street here. And I know we've gone through a lot of reconstruction and paving recently, but even throughout that paving, we did lose 6 spots to Hanover residents on the street, which is a concern because then, of course, 285 Hanover Street went up, which has 4 units, each of 2 people in it. So you took away 6 spots and added 8 new people to the street as well, just as a note. From being in the Islington Creek area, I'd love to see the other streets added back in. I think that does make sense. And yet I didn't know if the Penn Hollow Daniel Street parking garage, which is well under construction here, would help alleviate maybe some of the stress from the downtown employees parking here. Just to note that might help out with some of the congestion here and maybe make this a little bit more reasonable for residential parking. And then last question I just have is the 41% versus 75%. I think that was mentioned when Ollery was speaking in the very beginning. Does that mean there has to have to be a 75% vote in favor of this at the end? I'm just a little worried about that being a high number. I know it was mentioned that there are a lot of renters on the street and I think a lot of unactive participants. So I'm a little bit worried that the 75% getting there might be a little bit high for the people that would actually care about this more.
Okay, so certainly I'm happy to address your concerns, Andrew. The counts that were taken both during January, February 2019, July, September 2018, and also during when the bridge lot was closed last year, were taken at about 5 a.m., at about 1 p.m. at lunchtime, and about 6 p.m. when people are coming home or have come home from work. And certainly there's some folks that work a little bit later and come home a little bit later. I can say that from July to September 2018, prior to the Foundry being available for downtown employees, which were designated early on as the chief culprit of using this space, to the detriment of the residents. We did have at 4:30 a.m., we had 86% occupancy, which puts you at 1% higher than what the parking industry would look to as a trigger to take action of one way or another to try and open some more spaces. Again, in a monetized area, that would be, you know, changing pricing structures, things of that nature. And in this area, it would be, in this type of area, it would be applying a time limit and then enforcing it. At 1 p.m., the Islington Creek neighborhood in July of September 2018, prior to the garage opening, was at 78.7%, not reaching that 85% threshold. And at 6 p.m., the Islington Creek neighborhood from July to September of 2018, prior to the Foundry being opened, was at 88.4%. Now, the good news is, you know, we took those counts again after the garage opened. And again, these are winter counts, so it's not, they're not apples to apples. Mm-hmm. But the 4:30 a.m. counts in Islington Creek after after that open were less than 60%. Noontime or 1 o'clock p.m. was about 61%. 6 p.m. was about 70%, which means that, you know, in general, the parking industry would not look to take action unless you reach that 85% threshold. So I think, you know, not to make my response too lengthy, but also prudent to discuss is the counts during when the bridge lot was closed. We did obviously have a large amount of traffic reduced due to the COVID situation. So when the bridge lot closed, we did a lot of planning and understanding, trying to figure out where those cars were going to go. I think a big concern was that those vehicles were going to find their way into these neighborhoods. But what actually happened was, again, I mentioned this earlier, the Foundry saw a tremendous bump, almost a 400% bump in collections over that time period, indicating that a vast majority of those vehicles found their way to the Foundry that still were visiting the surrounding businesses, the visitor center, the folks that live over at Keefe may having visitors and things of that nature. So what we saw was in the early morning, about 5:30 a.m., during that time frame when the bridge lot was closed, and the anticipation was that some of those vehicles or many of those vehicles would make their way into those neighborhood streets. The early morning saw 70%, the afternoon count saw 69%, and the late count also saw 69%. There was only one street of the inventory of Hanover, McDonough, Pearl, Rock, Sudbury, Tanner, and Brewster, and that was Tanner Court, that an inventory of only 7 spaces that saw greater than 85%, which would then trigger a possible action. So it certainly appears that a lot of the traffic has found its way to the Foundry Garage. The 188 users of the Employee Downtown program, that would represent, in my view, 188 constituents that are no longer finding it necessary to find a space in the Islington Creek area, as the reduced price down there allows them to park on a 10-hour period for $3, which is 30 cents an hour, and it's been very popular. So it's important to understand where the actual numbers stand. Data is as strong as perception when presented properly, and I think that needs to be understood. So if I have not answered all of your questions, please remind me what I missed.
No, that's fine for right now. I do appreciate that input. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Next up, we have Laura Terry. Go ahead, Laura.
Thank you, everybody, for doing this tonight. I really appreciate it. Just a quick question. We look at the maps, and every map we get stops on McDonough Street, stops at Salem. So we don't know if it goes beyond that. Does it go? Because obviously McDonough goes Salem, Dover, and then actually a little bit beyond Dover. So we're just curious if that's included at the end of the street, or does it kind of just stop at some point?
So the original iteration had basically the entire length of McDonough. No changes were requested to McDonough Street. So if the map ends there, then I apologize. The idea was to go the entire length of that. I think that would take you past Cabot. That I think your assessment is correct on that.
Okay, thank you. That's it. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Laura. Next up, we have Gary Doyle. Go ahead, Gary.
Hello. This looks like a taking of a public asset, and with $100,000 a year cost. For free permits for those that live in the neighborhood. It seems like a wonderfully socialized way of correcting a problem which apparently doesn't exist given the occupancy numbers are so low based on the data the city's taken. So I'm very much disagree with moving forward with this for those reasons.
I understand and respect your opinion. I think the previous answer of making sure that your voice gets heard to the appropriate folks, I think you should reach out to the folks that represent you on council and let them know whether it's a positive or negative opinion, what you think, and so that they can make a vote that is indicative of the entire constituency. I think you should absolutely speak up.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Thank you, Gary. Next, we have Mark Siracusa. Go ahead, Mark.
Unmute. Good evening. I'm Larry. I reached out to Larry Catalo and asked him to turn on his volume. So he's having technical difficulties. Mm-hmm. So I offered to have him send me an email, and I just want to read it to you.
Sure.
Larry's the citywide neighborhood committee chairman. I'm one of the members. Mark, this is what it says. Let the neighborhood parking program coordinators help with funneling comments to the city. This is similar to the Baltimore MPP structure where the neighborhood helps the city monitor the program or report problems.
Yep.
Then it just says, tell them my auto problems with my computer. Thank you. So that's his best. That's what
I'll respond to you, Mark, and through you to Larry. Larry, I'm sorry you had difficulties tonight. I hope it wasn't on our end. Certainly we want everybody's voice heard. I agree with you. As you know, Baltimore was a big part of our study for the 2019 iteration of this program, as were several other cities, in conjunction with the research that you did on your own, which I thought was fantastic and very helpful, and it also helped us to reinforce what we learned ourselves through our studies. I think that a formation of a steering committee would probably be a good idea. In the last iteration of this, the steering committee was the group that reached out to the city, went back and forth on the different iterations of the program regarding to time links and mapping and things of that nature. And I think that's an excellent way for the public to be able to funnel and channel their outreach to the appropriate parties.
All right, thank you. I'm sending him an email based on your words.
Hopefully he can hear us, yeah.
Yeah.
He's got my number. He's free to call me if he needs to.
I'll put that in the email. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mark.
All right.
Okay, and Iris, up again. Go ahead, Iris, after Brooke.
Thank you very much. Stayed up because this is really important. Again, I'm at 198 Islington, and the more I listen, the more concerned I become. At first, when you said that this iteration excluded certain streets and allowed us to purchase a permit, it sounded like it might work. But now I understand that permit is expensive, very expensive. On top of the taxes that we pay, it's outrageous that we would have to pay such a fee to park on the street outside where we live for more than 2 hours, and most of us being seniors. This is really disturbing. And the answer that we should just get in touch with our counselor is very unsatisfying. What have we been doing tonight? We've been giving our input to you as a group. And you as a group should not only present to the council your package program, but should present the objections that you've heard tonight. I'm quite outraged and quite concerned that our ability to park on the street is being taken away. I appreciate your service and your efforts, but we have not been surveyed. We have not been included in this committee. We have had very little opportunity to provide input. And just telling us to call our counselor is really not an answer for the process that's been undertaken here. And the process going forward is still very unclear. Is this our last opportunity to have input other than to call our counselor? I just find that a small group of residents has put forward a proposal that is to the disadvantage of many more people. And I really hope you will understand that as you deliberate forward, and that you will communicate that to the council on our behalf. Thank you.
Ben, I'd like to address that if I might.
Yes, ma'am.
I think, and then chairman of the PTS committee could weigh in as well. I, I see that the next step for this conversation would be back to the Parking and Traffic Safety Committee, mm-hmm. where we would continue this discussion, Iris, just to speak to your point.
Well, if you could let us know how that process will unfold, we'll try and participate. Mm-hmm. But I find it really disturbing that a group was put together and did not include all of the people who will be affected.
So I share your sentiment, Iris. I think that everybody's voice needs to be heard. Sorry,
Chairman Whalen, go ahead.
Yeah, Iris, I share your concern. I can tell you that this has been put on hold for a year with COVID and with what's been happening downtown, and there's going to be plenty of public input. This is just a proposal right now. That's why we're having this meeting. It's going to go back to Parking, Traffic, and Safety, and then back to the council. So there'll be plenty of input that can take place, you know, moving forward. But this program has been put on hold for a year with the whole COVID and the shutdown of the city. So anyway, moving forward, there's going to be plenty of public input. The council at this point, it'll go to Parking, Traffic, and Safety for more discussion. There'll probably be another community meeting, and then I'll go back to the council. So there's going to be plenty of time for people to weigh in and modify and try to help and work with the program.
And to Councilor Whalen's point, I think that's highly prudent. I think that's exactly what should happen. I do want to address one other thing that that Iris mentioned before. In terms of the cost of the permits, that has not been determined yet. The cost of permitting, one way or the other, has been left as a to be determined by council. There isn't anything yet insofar as what the program might cost.
Well, someone said something about the cost of a foundry permit.
Okay, so the reference to that was for people that did not live in the neighborhood that wanted a permit anyway. The suggestion was that somebody that did not live on one of these streets that wanted to park there, the price for their permit would be greater than the price of the foundry with, I guess.
That's us, you're talking about us.
Okay.
That we would be charged that kind of fee to park for more than 2 hours on top of our taxes?
Then I think you need to be heard, yes, absolutely.
That's outrageous.
So I would encourage you to participate in forthcoming meetings.
We participated in the last community meeting. And I thought the whole thing had received enough negative input that it was not going forward. And now here we are again.
Again, this is a new version of this program that's been brought before us for to try and present to council and the parking division, the DPW and the city manager's office thought that a meeting like tonight would be an excellent opportunity for folks like yourself to put forth your opinions, whether they were positive or not positive. And then again, as Councilor Whalen mentioned, bring it back to PTS for further discussion and try to refine what is and is not acceptable to the majority constituency prior to it being brought to council.
Exactly, and that's why I'm asking that when you make that report, you include the negative feedback, not just the proposal
itself.
Absolutely,
absolutely.
Good, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Iris. Next up, Robin Hustledge again. Go ahead, Robin.
Hi, I just wanted to add, you know, the studies that were done, 2019, I think you said, Ben, a lot has happened in Portsmouth since that time. And of course, the impact of COVID, which has greatly reduced the numbers. And so when COVID hopefully resolves, it's going to be a mob scene in Portsmouth. I also wanted to say that, like the Heinemann building, you know, they're, I don't know if they've moved yet, but moving to their new home, they have a parking lot that they allow people to park overnight there. Mm-hmm. And also on the weekend, which it's jam-packed on the weekends. Yep. And that's like over 50 parking spots that people, residents that live here and visitors park there on a regular basis. So that is going to be developed. It's either going to be commercial where there's no parking required or residential, and then they'll have that parking. So that parking will go away. So that's immediately another 50 spots or more that you need in our neighborhood to deal with, you know, what's going on here. Compounding the problem is frequent approvals by the city's Board of Appeals for new developments that have requested fewer on-site parking spots. I think Liz mentioned this, that are required by code. As an example, you know, the Stady Bar and Grill down there on Deer Street, they just got approval. They want to put in 21 micro units, and they got approval to have zero parking spots on site. So do you think those people are going to pay $100 a month to go drive down Foundry Place, go up a couple of levels to park their car and pay $100 a month? Or do you think they're going to go two blocks into the neighborhood and park for free? That's what they're going to do. And so, like in today's paper, let me just tell you another development that's another 59 micro unit housing somebody else I think brought up, that's on Pleasant Street. The developer there asked for a reduction in required parking spots from 40 down to 24. That's 59 housing units. So where do you think them, and it's not just the people that live there, but their guests that come to visit them, where do you think they're going to park? They're going to go into the nearby South End neighborhood, and they're going to park for free. It is it's a hugely growing problem that the city has made even worse for the residents that live here by not requiring these new developments to have adequate parking. So I will leave it there, but it is not a problem created by the residents. It is a problem created by growing development and then the city approving for these developments without the needed parking. So
I'll try to address that as best I can. We can only take counts for the present. We can't take counts for the future, but we can try to project. The original culprit, so to speak, of the congestion in the area was downtown employees that were parking in, for a 10 or an 8 hour shift and walking into downtown. And the city has worked to address that by offering a highly discounted parking product at the Foundry Garage, which has been taken up by nearly 200 downtown employees, which is, in my view, a very big success.
That is
success. So I would refer anybody to I guess, I hate to throw anybody at the bus, but the planning department for whether or not approvals get made one way or the other on parking allotments for design of buildings. So certainly Director Rice can speak to that, or City Manager Connard. But I think that's would be the venue for that discussion. The positive news that I can give you is that what we do know on most recent numbers is, and again, this is, you know, obviously COVID reduced, but the folks that would use the bridge lot to frequent the businesses nearby by vast and large amounts went to the Foundry Garage, as evidenced by a 400% spike in revenues and occupancy at that facility throughout that time period, and little to no movement in the surrounding area. So there's no way for me to speak to whether or not somebody who may purchase or live in one of those apartments above Stady would choose to send their guests or themselves to the Foundry Garage. But one of the reasons the pricing is only $100 a month for residents that can show their residency in the area at the Foundry Garage is exactly that, to entice people. First and foremost, you know, to get the garage full. Secondly, to try and alleviate some of the traffic that was had been hampering the Hanover situation, especially in light of the upcoming renovations there. And thirdly, to put people in position to have a low cost alternative for resident parking that's in the area. And of course that offer is extended to anybody that lives in the Islington Creek neighborhood as well. We don't close off the sale of passes to folks that live in that neighborhood. If somebody wanted to utilize that facility, it's readily available, and we're happy to assist.
Thank you, Robin. Next up we have Nicole LaPierre. Go ahead, Nicole.
Hi, good evening. Just a couple points, so I hope you bear with me. I know Ben was just talking about the use of the foundry garage during the pop-up and how the foundry saw an increase when the Bridge Street lot was not being used by cars. Mm-hmm. One thing I'd like to note is the pop-up, you know, the neighborhood had a lot of discussions with them, and the pop-up in all of their advertising directed people to the foundry to garage. And in credit to them, they made a huge effort because they knew the neighborhood was upset mm-hmm. to get cars to go there. That they made that a priority. So I give them the credit for that. And as far as, so during COVID, the count in the neighborhood was definitely down, but I can tell you living here and witnessing it, it's back. I mean, there are people who work downtown, again, parking. I live on Rock Street, this weekend, I just happened to notice a young couple get out of a Massachusetts car and head downtown. So the pre-COVID problems are definitely back. I also want to reiterate what Robin was saying. There was some changes made to our recommendations and given back to us. And I'm not sure who made them either or how that happened. That's I don't know. But as time has gone by, you know, with COVID, we've lost time. So I don't know. There were things that were changed and I totally agree with her. It's not clear to me how that happened. And also, as Robin was saying, I live so close to Heinemann that I can assure you I watch it daily. And Heinemann is a well-utilized lot. Weekends, weekdays, even before it got dark and I knew there was going to be this meeting, I took a look over at Heinemann. When that lot gets developed, that's going to be, and if there is no action for some kind of parking initiative, that's going to be a huge problem. Because right now, they're just letting anyone use the lot because they've evacuated, or not evacuated, but you know, they've left the building to move on. So the way I see it too, there are four parties who have an interest in this, and it's the residents, workers, tourists, and developers. I know that the city has tried very hard also to promote the foundry garage with the $3 a day initiative for people working in town. And what's interesting, within the course of 1 week, I had one woman tell me she parks there, she's fine with it, it's great, it's clean, it's working out for her. And then another young woman say, I can't afford to park. I know this neighborhood has parking. Why would I pay to park when I can just park here? So there, you know, there still is unresolved issues with people working downtown. So those are just two examples of the mixed bag. As far as tourists go, I mean, we need their revenue. We really should get them out of the neighborhood and paying to park. And then developers, as Robin spoke to, and I think Liz did too, I mean, they're not being required to require parking for huge developments, and that ends up being a burden to the residents again. So I just don't see how we can't finally, after years and years, address residents' parking issues. And the thing is, the city of Portsmouth, for better or for worse, or if you like it or not, is becoming a bigger and more developed city. This problem is just not going away. And I know there's going to be a solution. There has to be. Not everyone is going to be 100% happy. And I also welcome all voices at the table, but I just think we have to keep going at this until we finally do resolve it. The can can't be kicked any further down the road, especially as we continue to boom and grow. And as I think it was Robin said, I mean, they're predicting this summer that it's going to be an enormous turnout in town with people wanting to get out. Okay, well, I've said enough. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Nicole. Next up, Ken Goldman.
Well, thank you. I think you guys are doing a great job and I appreciate your efforts. A couple of questions I got as this has gone along. Number one, I'm not in the affected area right now. But I do live on Islington Street between Cornwall and Rockingham. And you know what Ben referred to as the bleed over, I'm sure will happen. I personally am fortunate enough that I have parking, but I do get guests. My daughter and granddaughters come to visit. We have friends come over, and I can see what's going to happen now is all this stuff is going to move down through the neighborhood. And so we're going to start seeing the impact. And, you know, if that's going to be the case, I think it's incredibly unfair that people who are other residents of Islington Creek will have to pay like a, you know, an out of area fee for a permit. I think everyone in the neighborhood should be included, though I personally think everyone in the city, but I'm not going to go that far. Also, I keep hearing about the committee. And I live here in Islington Creek. No one has ever approached me, put a flyer in my mailbox or anything. I really don't know who these people are. I would like to have an opportunity to speak with them and get to know them and discuss this with them. Because, you know, as I said the first time, I really don't, you know, basically oppose this, but I want to make sure that if this project does go forward, it's done in a way that's fair to all of us. Those of us who are going to be in the affected area and those who aren't. And I just want to make sure that their problem doesn't suddenly become my problem. So I would really like to hear from someone who's on the committee and be able to speak with them and become part of the process. Thank you.
I think that in 2019, the committee did a fine job of reaching out to lots of folks. I'm not sure they got everybody. But in terms of flyering neighborhoods that the city has done, we put them out on the, you know, right after the PTS meeting on the 8th, we put them out Monday morning, we put them out again this afternoon, so that we put it on our Instagram and Twitter feeds, and the website, city website, parkportsmouth.com, that kind of thing, to try and make sure that everybody was aware that tonight's meeting was going to take place, and to give folks on either side of the aisle the opportunity to put their opinions forward and try to shape this program into something that the entire neighborhood could be happy with and proud of.
Yeah, no, I have no problem with the way the city's handling it. I think you guys are doing tremendous. I was able to, sign up for the meeting very easily, and I knew it was happening. But, if I can find a way to connect with my neighbors and speak to them, that would be great. And I just don't really know how to do that. My involvement in this really started because I live on Islington Street and they wanted to just, flush us out of the program. If this does go forward, I just want to make sure it does go forward in a way that's equitable to everyone in the neighborhood and in a broader sense to people in the city as a whole.
Okay, thank you again. Next we have Dan Umbro. Dan, go ahead, Dan.
Thank you. just two brief comments, and I think it's been a really healthy discussion. I know, in 2019, this was a contentious issue for a lot of different people. I'd like to think that, with new iterations and an open mind, I think an equitable solution can be made. But it's just the two points I'd like to be made, and I think it's very important. I think a lot of people, either sides of opinion can make, speculative points about what people will do and where they'll park based off of these programs or even the current, landscape of parking in that neighborhood. I just think it's really important to use data to back up these statements. And I think that, especially during the phase where the council is voting, just we need to present the data in a smart way where people making these decisions can be informed about the actual data surrounding whether or not it's good or bad policy. That's my main point. And I hope the council takes everybody's perspective. And again, I know Robin and Nicole both mentioned that they're not sure how the iteration of what they had sent over to the city as a proposal removed certain aspects or streets. I know Robin mentioned that she wasn't sure how businesses got excluded from the permit program. So I'd just be kind of curious to know, why they weren't and who took that out and where that exclusion came from. Because again, I think, you know, in order to get an equitable solution for everybody here, we need all stakeholders to be represented.
Well, I would concur with that. And I think that, again, the continuation of the discussion is absolutely paramount to a successful program going forward.
Thank you, Dan. Next up, we have Liza Hewitt. Go ahead, Liza.
Hi. I have a question about rentals, and I don't know if you've even given this any thought. It's kind of a more technical question. But if you are a tenant, how are these permits going to be applied for? Will this be the landlord's responsibility or the tenant's responsibility? What are you going to be looking for proof of residence? And what happens if you are a landlord and you have tenants in and halfway through the pilot program, they move out? Do those permits go with them? Or are you able to say, you know, they've moved and you need more permits? I mean, have you given any of that any thought? Thank you.
Well, I can say the current programs that we have that revolve around residency require three proofs. One would be a vehicle registration, the other being a proof of address via a utility bill or a fully executed lease. There are some considerations on the website. You know, I don't want to quote them all, lest that I miss one. But we do have that laid out, what residency requirements are. My suggestion to your comment would be that, A, hopefully we wouldn't see a whole lot of folks leaving mid-year, but when they did happen, that we would try to rely on the landlord to let us know. You would have in the case of a permit, you would have that the sticker would be affixed to that vehicle permanently or to the necessity of using a scraper to get it off, so to speak, like any other AAA sticker, what have you. So when that tenant were to vacate, the next tenant would obviously not be able to have access to that sticker, then would require their landlord or inquire of their landlord to say, you know, where do I get one of these passes? And the landlord would then be compelled to reach out to the parking division so that we could delete the passes that were originally applied to that particular property. And then, you know, reissue passes to the new tenants where we had their vehicle information, their plate, their color, their make, their model, and that sort of thing. And then assure that new sticker with the new number and the new decal was affixed to that vehicle in a permanent manner. Does that answer everything?
Okay. All right.
Yes.
Thank you, Liza. Next up is Liz Bratter. Go ahead, Liz.
Sorry about that. I was just going to let Ken know that he's on my email list for something else, and I can email him about the parking program.
Cool. I don't see anyone else with their hand raised at this time. So in a few minutes in case anyone has a question.
Oh, looks like Dan raised his hand again.
Okay. Go ahead, Dan.
Liz, I would love to be included in that email chain. I don't know if it's specific to Islington Creek residents, but again, if you'd be willing to involve me in any discussions, it would be appreciated.
Thank you, Dan. Next, we have Mayor Beckstead. Is it? Go ahead, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening. Rick Beckstead, 1395 Islington Street. I'm speaking tonight as a resident of Portsmouth. Just want a couple of quick points with people. So a couple of residents have gone and mentioned about development and the stadium that was approved by the planning board to have zero parking. I would highly recommend that residents watch that meeting, because the chairman of that board actually so claimed and said that it was time for the city of Portsmouth to do a resident parking program. So our boards have gone and implicated that this might be something that needs to be looked at. And this is the one neighborhood that has asked the longest to address their concerns. And I believe personally that it is our duty to be able to go and look at this neighborhood. The roads, I believe, were reduced to try not to impact as many people that were concerned the last time around, which is a reduction that's in there. We need, as a city, to try to do something. This neighborhood is a perfect example of a place that we can go and take 6 months to be able to study this area, do our due diligence, get the data that everyone is talking about, that Ben then can take that data and see if a resident parking program is possible within the city. This is a small section, largely impacted, many concerns, and I think that this is the perfect place to be able to go and do it. And it will be part of many discussions, I'm sure, hearing everyone out there tonight. There'll be more than two or three meetings, I'm sure. So we will do our best to be able to go and address everyone's concerns. And I just wanted to make a few points, and thank you everyone for attending the meeting. It was nice to be able to see several people out there. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, next up is Dan Umbro again. Go ahead, Dan.
I think I did that on accident.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
And looks like I have Liz Bratter. Liz?
Sorry.
Oh, I think I just muted her. Sorry about that, Liz.
Sorry, no, I'm sorry because I thought I had put my hand down, but I guess it's up, so I'm confused. Sorry, I can't get.
So Eric, it looks like we don't have anybody else raising their hand. I guess the appropriate thing at this point is to thank everybody for attending. I think it's obviously it's part of the civic duty to listen and hear from the constituency. It's one of the favorite parts of the job as far as I'm concerned. So without any further ado, unless it's Honorable City Manager or Director Rice has anything further to say, I'm more than happy to go ahead and close this meeting and then look for the future for future meetings.
Thanks, Ben. Thank you, Ben and Eric for making this happen, and Peter for your support of them.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thanks, guys. It was a great night for the residents, so thank you.
Yeah, really good input. Thank you all.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, so reporting now.